see everybody here. Welcome if you're joining us online. Grateful you could be with us here today at Vessel Church. Man, you guys look good. I'm excited. It's an exciting time of year here in Western New York. The leaves will be changing soon. It's a time where we can just be thinking about having a great ending to our year. And today I wanted to take a look at what God wants for our life, what God would want for your individual life. So what God will teach us through his word. I want to begin here in Psalm 43, verses 3 and 4. And the writer says, "Send your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy mountain, to your dwelling place. Then I will come to the altar of God, to God, my greatest joy." You see what he's saying? He's, "Send your light, send your truth. Lead me to your mountain, your holy mountain." And today that's our church. God's church on earth is his holy Mount Zion. And God wants us to be on the mountaintop. It's what he aspires for us. And so the writer says, "Send your light and your truth." And so it's not a coincidence that when Jesus came in John 8, he said, "I am the light of the world." John 14, 6, he says, "I am the way and the truth and the life." Jesus is that light. Jesus is that truth that can lead us to the mountain of God. God wants us to have a mountaintop experience. God wants us to have a full and abundant life. Not a life that is based on, or not a joy that's based on, you know, money and being wealthy or fame, and not that those are sinful, but like our life shouldn't have to depend on those things. Our life can be full of joy and purpose and love and fulfillment. That's the life God wants to us. He wants us to have that mountaintop experience of living a life where you feel fulfilled, where you feel great about your life. That's what God wants for us. So why do we sometimes settle for less than what God offers us? Why do we run after other things when God says, "I want you to have a full and abundant life. I want you to come to the mountaintop"? You know, this year, you know, like every year, the football season is about to begin. And, you know, we here in Western New York, Buffalo Bills fans, and, you know, if you would ask 100 Bills fans this question, and probably in other cities too, do you want a Super Bowl victory, or are you going to be good with them just getting close? I mean, I think we'd all be like, "No, we need the Super Bowl. We've been close." Most cities would be like, "No, I'm not happy we'll get close. We want the Super Bowl," right? Because that's how we're built. We want that victory. We aren't going to settle for less with our football team, so why would we do that spiritually? You know, we like the mountaintop experience. We love the accomplishment. We love what comes with that. You know, many people love climbing mountains. You know, my daughter Lydia and her husband Alex, they love hiking mountains. You know, they go to the Adirondacks fairly often, and their goal is to reach all the 46 peaks. I think they're at 17 right now, but here's a picture of them, and they love to do it. And when they get to the top, they send us those pictures, they'll FaceTime us, like, "Man, we made it to the top," you know, and they're so excited. You know, we love those mountaintop experiences. Or, you know, I remember a few years back, Lydia and I were in Hollywood, and we wanted to climb the Hollywood Mountain to get to the sign, and it was an arduous journey. I mean, it took a while to get up there. It was tough. But then we get up there, and here's a picture, actually, from behind the Hollywood sign. We're like, "Yes!" Yeah, we FaceTime my wife, and we're like, "We made it to the top." You know, people are always sending those pictures, right? "We made it to the mountaintop." Did you ever notice nobody sends pictures and says, "We made it three quarters of the way up. We're going back, though." I think nobody wants to send those. Nobody wants to see those, right? It's all about reaching the mountaintop. So today, I want you to hold on to one thing. If you leave here with one thing, I want you to remember this. Don't settle for less when God wants to bless. Don't settle for less when God wants to bless you. Don't settle for mediocrity. Don't settle for less when God wants to bless. So we're going to look here at a story today. Honestly, it's a cautionary tale where we can learn from some mistakes and sin so that it would inspire us and challenge us to always go with God to the mountaintop and not settle for less. You know, most of us know Abraham in the Bible, in the Old Testament. He's the father of faith, you know, as he's called by many people. And he was a great man of God. But I want to look at his nephew, whose name was Lot. And I wanted to look at Lot for a second here to see what we could learn. You see, Lot lived in Sodom. We may have heard of Sodom and Gomorrah. And we're going to read more about it. He chose to live in Sodom. It was a very sinful place, dangerous place. He chose to live there. It was so bad that God sent his angels down there to say, man, we need to check this place out and see what we need to do with deal with it. So that's the situation we're going to look at here with Lot and his family living in Sodom. The angels are coming down to check out and see what's going on because all the reports of their sin and danger, right? This is where we pick up. So we're going to begin here in Genesis 19, verse 1. It says, the two angels entered Sodom in the evening, and Lot was sitting in Sodom's gateway. When Lot saw them, he got up to meet them. He bowed with his face to the ground and said, my lords, turn aside to your servant's house, wash your feet, and spend the night. Then you can get up early and go on your way. No, they said, we would rather spend the night in the square. I'm guessing because they wanted to see the city, get to know what was actually going on, be in the middle of it. So it says, he prepared a feast and baked unleavened bread for them, and they ate. Because he had urged them strongly to come to his house, right? Before they went to bed, the men in the city of Sodom, both young and old, the whole population surrounded the house. They called out to Lot and said, where are the men who came to you tonight? Send them out to us so that we could have sex with them. Lot went out to them at the entrance and shut the door behind him. He said, don't do this evil, my brothers. Look, I've got two daughters who haven't been intimate with a man. I'll bring them out to you, and you could do whatever you want to them. However, don't do anything to these men because they have come under the protection of my roof. Get out of the way, they said, adding, this one came here as an alien, but he's acting like a judge. Now we'll do more harm to you than to them. They put pressure on Lot and came up to break down the door, but the angels reached out, brought Lot into the house with them, and shut the door. They struck the men who were at the entrance of the house, both young and old, with blindness, so they were unable to find the entrance. Wow. This is a lot to unpack, right? This is a bad situation. So many things that just make you raise your eyebrows and say, what is going on, right? It's disturbing. You know, we know from Genesis chapter 13, verses 12 and 13, Lot was with Abraham, and they were trying to figure out where to live, and they both had large flocks and things, so they couldn't be in the exact same place. So Abraham's like, you go one place, I'll go to the other. Choose where you want to go. Lot, and this is very important, Lot chose to live in Sodom. And even at that time, he knew the reputation was it was a sinful and dangerous place. He chose to live there, though. Maybe for worldly reasons. Maybe he felt like he could get wealthy there. He could make a living there. But for whatever reason, he chose to live in this sinful city. I mean, he was so scared that the angels would be abused. And some. He was like, don't stay in the square. Come to my house. He pleaded with them to do that because he was so scared what might happen. Because he knew, obviously, the danger of that city, the sin that that city was in. It got so bad that he offered up his daughters to be gang raped. I mean, that's crazy. And you think, wow, that is just, but he chose to live amidst the sin and the danger. You see, choices are so crucial in our walk, so crucial in our relationship with God, so crucial just in our life. Because you can make a bad choice, and many times it could lead you into other situations where you make more bad choices. And obviously you could see Lot went to this sinful city, and then a situation came up where it was dangerous, and now he's offering his daughters, he's getting crazy with it. But that's what happens many times when you make that sinful choice. Is it can lead to other sinful choices and pain. But that's not what God wants. So why do we allow ourselves to stay in sinful or dangerous situations rather than fleeing to spiritual safety, which God always offers to us? That if we follow his way and his principles, we will live in spiritual safety. We will be able to reach the mountaintop. We'll get through the challenge. Guys, remember again, don't settle for less when God wants to bless. Can I hear you say it? Turn to the person next to you and say it with me. Don't settle for less when God wants to bless. Yes. I think you can say it with more conviction, so we'll revisit that a little bit later. But it's so true. Lot was not accepting the opportunities that God gave him to live safe and righteous spiritually and in his life. So we go on. Verse 12. Then the angel said to Lot, do you have anyone else here, a son-in-law, your sons and daughters, or anyone else in the city who belongs to you? Get them out of this place. For we are about to destroy this place because the outcry against this people is so great before the Lord that the Lord has sent us to destroy it. So Lot went out and spoke to his sons-in-law, who were going to marry his daughters. Get up, he said. Get out of this place, for the Lord is about to destroy the city. But his son-in-laws thought he was joking. Wow. So ask yourself the question. Where did they learn to ignore God's warnings? Where did they learn to not heed God's direction? Just think about it for a second. How are they influenced to be that way? Why were they not looking to the patriarch of their family? And when he says, look, God tells us to get out, why did they think he was joking and not take him serious? Where did they learn that? My guess would be it's from Lot and his sinful choices, his faithless choices over time, as we already see here. And so they don't listen to what God has to say. You know, influence. We can influence people for the good or even for the bad. We can be influenced for the good or the bad. It makes such a difference how we live in our faith for our children and our friends and our coworkers and everyone else. What do we see? Maybe you were raised in a certain way that caused you to have sinful patterns that you've had to work hard to break your whole life. Influence, our example, how we actually live, not our words, but how we actually live is so important. You know, a few chapters before, God comes and tells Abraham, I'm going to bless you. You're going to have a child, and he's going to lead to you being blessed, and many nations are going to come because of you. Now, Abraham had seen God do miracles. He had been walking with God. Now, he was old. He was almost 100 years old. So when God said, I'm going to give you a child, you know what Abraham did? He laughed. How could I possibly have children in this old age? You know what's interesting? Is a short time later when God comes to his wife Sarah and says the same thing. I'm going to give you a child in your old age. And he will be blessed. And your family will be blessed. And many nations will come from you. Do you know what Sarah did? She laughed. She laughed at God. And God said, why did you laugh? And then she lied. She said, no, I didn't laugh. And God said, no, you did laugh. Where did she learn that attitude? From her husband who laughed at God? Where did she learn to lie? From Abraham who lied a little earlier about Hagar? You see the influence? How it can be negative, but it can also be powerful. It can also be positive. It's all what our choices are based on. Here we see a situation where Lot, because of his choices, we're influencing people around him to not heed God's word. Don't settle for less when God wants to bless. God wanted to save them. He wanted to save his family. He's like, man, get them out of here. God wanted to bless them with safety. But his family had gotten lazy, and they weren't heeding God's call. Let's go on, verse 12, or verse after this. So it says in verse 15, at daybreak, the angels urged Lot on. Get up, take your wife and your two daughters who are here, or you'll be swept away in the punishment of the city. So Lot got his family and urgently heeded the call. And went, no, it's not what it says, is it? It says, but he hesitated. He hesitated. These were angels of God. He had already seen them strike all the people with blindness. He knew they were angels. They were doing miracles. So they say, get your family out. The Bible says he hesitated. Why was he still lingering in this place, this sinful, dangerous place, the place that the angels told him to leave because they're going to destroy it, and yet he's still slow to listen to God. He's still hesitant. Don't settle for less when God wants to bless. He was settling for less. Today, ask yourself the question, do you find yourself lingering, hesitating to truly do things God's way? Do you find yourself lingering in sinful situations you know you should get out of, where there's temptation, where there's compromise? It could be a relationship. It could be a workplace. It could be even within your family. Do we allow these situations to go on? Do we linger rather than doing things God's way, heeding God's call and getting that spiritual safety, getting under the spiritual umbrella of protection that God offers us? Abraham was not fleeing the dangerous situation. He was hesitating. And you think, wow, you think he'd know by now. It's time to go. Heed the angel's call. Guys, don't settle for less when God wants to bless you. Don't linger in sin. Let's continue on. Check out what the angels do now. Because of the Lord's compassion for him, the men grabbed his hand, his wife's hand, and the hands of his two daughters. They brought him out and left him outside the city. As soon as the angels got them outside, one of them said, "Run for your lives. Don't look back. And don't stop anywhere on the plain. Run to the mountains or you will be swept away." But Lot said to them, "No, my lords, please. Your servant has indeed found favor with you, and you have shown me great kindness by saving my life. But I can't run to the mountains. The disaster will overtake me and I will die. Look, this town is close enough for me to flee to. It's a small place. Please let me run to it. It's only a small place, isn't it, so that I can survive?" I mean, are you hearing this? Are you seeing what he's doing? It's like, get out of here. Don't look back. Flee. He's still arguing with them. No. I mean, the angel literally says, "Go to the mountain, you'll be safe." He's like, "No, I won't be able to make it." Even though the angel promised him he could. He could have the mountaintop. But he chose the small little city. He wanted things his way. "No, I want to do it my way. This is how I want it to go down." We're going to find out later, the only reason the angels put up with him is because of his father Abraham and Abraham's faith. So they put up with this attitude of his. They literally grab him by the hand to get him out of there, him and his family. And they're like, "Don't look back." Lot's still not listening. How about us? Are we listening to the word? Are we listening to God when he's telling us how to get to spiritual safety, how to have victory, how to prosper? Or do we linger? Do we hesitate? Do we bicker with God? I mean, it's frightening to see what this is. Well, and let's go on. And he said to him, "All right, I'll grant your request about this matter too, and will not demolish the town you mentioned. Hurry up, run to it, for I cannot do anything until you get there. Therefore, the name of the city is Zoar." Now, Zoar literally means small. The sun had risen over the land when Lot reached Zoar. Then out of the sky, the Lord rained on Sodom and Gomorrah, burning sulfur from the Lord. He demolished these cities, the entire plain, all the inhabitants of the cities, and whatever grew on the ground. But Lot's wife looked back and became a pillar of salt. Wow. You know, just as a side note here, I love archaeology. And here's a picture, actually, of Sodom and Gomorrah today. And what they found is the city, it's desolate, obviously, destroyed. But the city lays under a whole coating of sulfur and ash, just as the Bible describes it. And then the next picture here, here's one of the archaeologists actually at one of the houses that they found, ancient houses, holding up a ball of sulfur there in that area. It's crazy, man, how archaeology and science back up the Bible so much. That's just extra, guys, on the side right there. But look at this. Again, Lot's wife doesn't obey the angels when they say, "Don't look back, flee, run." She looked back and became a pillar of salt. She looked back. She disobeyed them. Where might she have learned that attitude? Influence. She kept seeing her husband arguing with the angels, hesitating when they were called to do something by God. And so she then did the same thing and turned into a pillar of salt. Guys, don't settle for less when God wants to bless. He wants you to flee to safety, wants to get you to the mountaintop, wants to bless you. Don't argue. Don't settle. Don't look back. You know, Jesus even says this in the New Testament when he's talking to his disciples and those who are saying, "We want to follow you." In Luke 9:62, Jesus says to them, "No one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God." Do you see what he's saying? Look forward. Trust me. Come with me. Don't be looking back to your old life. Don't be looking back to your sinful ways. Don't be doubting and hesitating and lingering. No, look forward. Jesus says that to us as disciples today. This story is a cautionary tale, something we can learn from. Learn the dangers of arguing with God, disobeying God, settling for less when God wants to bless. Let me ask you today, do you look back to your old ways? Do you look back to your sinful past, maybe with rose-colored glasses? Oh, it wasn't that bad. Maybe you get sentimental. Oh, you know, I think back, we used to have fun, but you start talking yourself into the past. Maybe because you're going through a trial or a challenge and you don't understand why God's allowing you to go through it. And so you start questioning and, man, you know, God, and you start looking back and, yeah, man, maybe I should go back. It's like what they did when he brought them out of Egypt, out from their slavery. They had been calling out to God for hundreds of years, and God heard them and sent a deliverer, Moses, and brought them out of Egypt, and they went into the desert, and what did they start doing? Complaining. Oh, we should have stayed back in Egypt. There was better food there. Really? Now you're going to start looking back. So your literal slavery, we can do that as well when we start looking back to our past, when we were slaves to sin, when we were compromising. And we can do the same thing instead of looking forward. God's like, no, look forward. Run to the mountain. I'm bringing you to my holy mountain. Jesus will lead you to my holy mountain. Jesus will take you by the hand of the holy mountain. Trust me, trust Jesus to have victory, to get on that mountaintop, to be able to take your heavenly selfie someday. Look with Jesus, yeah. The mountaintop. Because you don't want to take selfies from the other place. God offered them the mountain, but they chose Zoar. I mean, he literally had seen the angels do miracles, and he didn't heed their call. My question for us today is, do we accept a Zoar walk with God? A mediocre walk with God, instead of striving to have an excellent, powerful faith. Do we settle for a Zoar faith? Well, you know, I'm a Christian. You know, I come to church, you know. But we don't really strive for excellence, strive for greatness, strive for victory because God says, do this. And we think, oh, it's too hard, or what if I fail? Listen, you already failed. We're lost. We need Jesus. When you get saved, it's good. Follow him. Continue to trust him. He got you there. He will get us to heaven. He will get us to God's holy mountain. But are you accepting a Zoar Bible study? Is your Bible study weak? Or do you just kind of fit in a few minutes here and there rather than really sitting down for the banquet feast of the Word of God? Do you settle for Zoar prayers where it's just, oh, you know, God, if you could help me, I don't know. Or is it like, God, I want to do great things. God, help me to have great faith. God, help me to be strong in the face of trials. God, I want to make a difference in my world. Or do we just settle for a Zoar life, Zoar expectations, where we just go about our day, but we're not really praying for God to work powerfully in our life, work powerfully in all that we have an endeavor for? I mean, let me tell you something. Zoar didn't work out for Lot and his sons, his daughters. It didn't work out for his family. He went there. He didn't last there long. He had to flee to where? The mountains and live in they literally ended up living in a cave. Their life was not good. That choice did not lead to good things. And here's actually a picture of Zoar today. Desolate. A distant memory. And it's what he gave his life to. Rather than going to the mountaintop and celebrating with the people of God. Guys, we have to push through the tough spots in our life with faith to reach the mountaintop. It takes a little work sometimes. It takes perseverance, but it gets us to the mountaintop. It gets us to victory. And God wants that for us. He wants you to have a mountaintop marriage, a mountaintop kids, mountaintop parenting, mountaintop victory in your life, in your job, in your relationships, everywhere. That's what God wants. He doesn't want you to have a Zoar marriage, a Zoar parenting situation. God wants the mountaintop for you. We've got to put in the effort, the faith, to see victory. Let me tell you, I heard this recently. The difference between try and triumph is just a little oomph. Man, put in that effort, put in that toughness, put in that faith. Watch God get you through a situation and lead you to victory. Man, I gotta tell you right now, I'm so inspired by our Sun Chasers group in the church, because they're not going to settle for less when God wants to bless. You know, campus, over the past few years, it had gotten very anti-God. It was politically incorrect to be a Christian. The students were going out there and sharing their faith and trying to make a difference, and people were unwelcoming to them. They were against God, and I remember they were like, man, this is so tough. It's so anti-God. But you know what? We have this worship concert coming up, this big praise service on the 14th. You know what our students did? They had faith. They went back out to campus, and they started sharing their faith. They didn't settle and say, well, you know, campus isn't open, so we're not going to try. No, they went out there with faith. They were bold, and they are meeting people left and right that are interested in God and wanting to come out to a praise service, wanting to know more about God, because they didn't quit. Man, they're getting me pumped. I get up, man, I see the stories that they're sharing. I'm like, man, this is so awesome. It gets my blood going. Man, these guys are not settling for less. They're going for the mountaintop. And you know what? I've never seen such joy on their faces. Going out. It's time that we all listen to God. We look forward and not back. We follow Jesus to the mountaintop and quit settling for Zoar. Quit looking back to a sinful past. Quit compromising. Trust God and be on the mountaintop of victory. As we take communion now together, let me just tell you that the cross should remind us how badly God wants to bless us. That he sent his son down to suffer and die. He sent his light and his truth to guide us to the holy mountain. The cross should remind us how badly God wants to bless us and get us to that mountaintop. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the opportunity we have to learn from others' mistakes, to be able to know that you want triumph for us and victory. Thank you for Jesus dying on the cross so that we could have that open door to the mountaintop. We just have faith, God. Thank you for that sacrifice. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Guys, thank you so much for being here with us today. Grateful you could join us. I pray that you would learn from this cautionary tale and set yourself on a path to new heights. Set yourself on a path to victory, heading for that mountaintop with God. We're so grateful you're with us today. If you're online, grateful to have you here with us today too. Maybe drop a comment. Let us know where you're watching from. We'd love to hear from you. Thank you again. Have an awesome week.
Thank you so much for joining us this Sunday here on Vessel Church YouTube channel. We go live every single Sunday, so please make sure you like, share, and subscribe to our channel so that you can stay up to date on everything that we do. We'll see you guys really soon. Enjoy your week, and please remember that when you're in our house, we hope you feel welcome.